Yeah. Congregation, please be seated. And now we will listen to the ancient words, first of the prophets, and then the apostles, and finally from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. The first reading is from the revelation of Jesus Christ as written by John the Apostle. Then I saw another angel flying high overhead with eternal good news to proclaim to those who live on earth, and to every nation, tribe, language, and people. He said in a loud voice, "Fear God and give him glory, for the hour of his judgment has come. Worship the one who made heaven and earth, the sea and springs of water. This is the word of the Lord." The second reading is from St. Paul's letter to the Romans, chapter 3. Now we know that whatever the law says, it speaks to those who are under the law, in order to shut every mouth and make it so the whole world has to answer to God. It follows that no human being will be treated as righteous in his presence by doing what the law says, because the knowledge of sin comes through the law. But now God's righteousness has been revealed apart from the law, which is confirmed by the law and the prophets. God's righteousness comes through the faithfulness of Jesus Christ for all who have faith in him. There is no distinction. Together, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God and are justified by his grace as a gift through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus. Through his faithfulness, God displayed Jesus as the place of sacrifice where mercy is found by means of his blood. He did this to demonstrate his righteousness in passing over sins that happened before, during the time of God's patient tolerance. He also did this to demonstrate that he is righteous in the present time, and to treat the one who has faith in Jesus as righteous. What has happened to our bragging? It's thrown out. With which law? With what we have accomplished under the law? No, not at all, but through the law of faith. We consider that a person is treated as righteous by faith, apart from what is accomplished under the law. This is the word of the Lord. And the third reading comes from the Gospel according to St. John, the 8th chapter. Jesus said to the Jews who believed in him, "You are truly my disciples if you remain faithful to my teaching. Then you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free." They responded, "We are Abraham's children. We've never been anyone's slaves. How can you say that we will be set free?" Jesus answered, "I assure you that everyone who sins is a slave to sin. A slave isn't a permanent member of the household, but a son is. Therefore, if the Son makes you free, you really will be free." This is the word of the Lord. At this time, we invite all the children of the Sunday school to come forward for singing a couple of things here.
All right, everybody come on up on the top here and sit up here, okay? And if all the rest of the children that did not sing, come on up, all right? Come on up. And you guys make room for them, okay? I'm going to sit over here. No, there isn't candy. No, there isn't. All right. Come on up. Make room now, guys, okay?
It's Tootsie Rolls, not
my favorite kind of candy.
Wonderful. You're going to find out in just a second. We got to wait for everyone to come on up. You do want the chocolate, huh?
I want the Tootsie Roll.
Awesome. So I've got a jar, sort of a vase of Tootsie Rolls, and if I wanted something that was this delicious, then I would just reach in and grab one. See, I got one in my hand.
Is your hand stuck?
It is. Uh-oh. I got the Tootsie Roll. You can see it, right? I got the Tootsie Roll in my hand. But if I grab it, I can't get my hand out. But I want it. And so I'm going to have to find a different way. Now, if I grab it, even though I want it really bad, I can't get it out. You know, the only way to do this is to pour it out. Yeah, I got to open my hand up and have it poured out. This is like God's love. We want God's love. We want the forgiveness of our sins and eternal life. And sometimes we want to grab it, but we can't grab it. There is nothing we can do to get God's love. There is nothing we can do to grab God's love. All we can do by the Holy Spirit is open our hands and He pours it out. And He pours us even more than we could want. No, don't touch it. There you go. Okay? That's the only way we can receive the goodness of God, the love of God. He sent Jesus. We can't grab Jesus. We can only receive Jesus with an open hand. And that's what God's word tells us. So let's pray about that now. You fold your hands, okay, and you repeat after me.
Dear God,
we thank you for giving us
your love
in Jesus Christ,
who died and rose
to save us.
Help us
to receive your love and share your love with other people. And all God's children said, Amen. Now, I do have bags of candy back here. However, here's the trick. Here's the deal, okay? You're going to get one, but you can't open it until you talk to Mom and Dad. Now, Mom and Dad also know about this, so you're going to have to share with them, I think, too. You're not going to be able to hide it, so. All right? You want to help out here? You can do it on that side. Hopefully we've got enough for everybody. We should. All right. No opening until you talk to Mom and Dad. Once you get one, you can go back to your seats. Thanks for coming. And we can continue with the singing of the next song. Okay, guys?
Thank you.
Grace to you and peace from God our Father and from Jesus Christ the Lord. Amen. Nancy and I were in a furniture store a couple weeks ago, and we're looking for a new couch because we're going to be hosting a Christmas open house the Sunday before Christmas for all of you. And so we needed more seating space in our living room at the parsonage right over here. And so you're going to all be invited, and we're going to have cookies, and we're going to have punch and hot chocolate and coffee. It's going to be a great afternoon. I think we've just guaranteed a lot of snow by holding a party at the house. That's still usually the way it works. Every summer we had a party at the house for the various leadership in the congregation, and I think it rained at just about all of them except one. So anyway, but that we were looking for a new couch. We needed more space. So we were at the furniture store, and we're walking around, and we're looking at different types of couches and different configurations and different colors and different fabrics. And I begin to notice that there was this older couple kind of following us around. And they were looking at the same couches that we were. Well, I struck up a conversation with them. And we began to talk, and we found we had a lot of the same taste in color and fabric and style. And we finally found a couch we would want, and we bought it, and it's over at the house now. And as we were, you know, purchasing it and completing the purchase and the extended warranty and the service plan and all the things that you do for major purchases like that, the couple came over and says, "We like you." They knew I was a pastor. See, they knew what we were doing and why we were doing it for the parsonage and having our church come over, and said, "Don't be surprised if we come and visit your church someday." I said, "You're welcome. Everybody is welcome to come to St. Matthew in Hawthorn Woods." And then she warned me, "But I'll warn you, I'm a staunch Catholic." And I said, "That's okay. We're an open congregation. You can come here even if you're a staunch Catholic. And by the way, we're Catholic too. We're just Reformed Catholic. We are all Catholic. Every Christian is Catholic. Because the word Catholic means universal." And I'll get to that in a second. But this weekend, boy, this is the weekend that Lutheran Catholics really shine. This is our weekend. Reformation weekend. This is the weekend that we tell the whole world what it means to call ourselves Lutheran. Do you know that originally the word Lutheran was meant as an insult? It was used by the leaders of the Roman Catholic Church to mock and insult the followers of that German monk, Martin Luther. But given any insult 500 years and it turns into a badge of honor, which it is for me, I am honored and privileged and humbled to be able to call myself a Lutheran. Now, there is Catholic and then there's Catholic. There is Catholic with a capital C, which is what we would normally designate those who follow the Roman Catholic Church and religion, and Catholic with a little c. And that's the one that we all are. Catholic with a little c simply means universal. It is a word that was meant to convey that time and space mean nothing to a Christian. We are Christian no matter where we are in the world, and we are Christian no matter when we are, whether it was 2,000 years ago or today in the 21st century. That's what the word Catholic little c means. Lutherans are part of that kind of church. All Christians, even Lutherans, are Catholic. And to be Catholic or to even be Lutheran means just one thing, however. It means we have Jesus Christ as our center. Jesus Christ as our center means that we get back to the basics of who we are and how we got that way. Because of Adam and Eve, we are all sinners. They fell into sin in the Garden of Eden, and we are all descendants of Adam and Eve. And so their original sin has been passed on to us. And even today, we still sin. For those who take sermon notes, that's our confirmation students. Oops. You'll remember, right? You'll watch it later on demand a little bit later on. This is the law part of the sermon, where we hear about how we are sinners. First use of the law is in the epistle lesson today, in that second reading from Romans. It shows us our sin. And we still sin today. Just turn on TV, open a newspaper, for those of you who still do that, or look in the news feed on your iPad or your phone, and we're still sinning today. And over 7,000 years or more since Adam and Eve, we still have not found a way by ourselves to fix the problem. Because there is only one fix for this problem, and that is Jesus Christ. And this is the gospel. Jesus Christ was born to be our substitute under that law that we can't keep. He kept it perfectly for us. He lived perfectly so that that perfect life can be given to us by faith. I'll bring that up again in just a moment. And then Jesus died on the cross. Why? To forgive all our sins. Because we still sin. We needed to get that taken care of. So Jesus died to forgive all the sins of all people of all time, all the way back to Adam and Eve. 3 days later, Jesus rose from the dead. And that's an indication that while all people will rise from the dead, those who are Christians will rise to eternal life. Because Jesus ascended into heaven, he promised to come back and take all believers in Jesus back to heaven to be there and live there forever in the presence of God. That is our gospel that we articulate here at St. Matthew in that way. Now, that happened 2,000 years ago, but over 1,500 years, people muddied the waters again with sin. Here's some more law. You see, the Bible indicates that we are saved by faith alone. We are saved by grace through faith alone, without any merit or worthiness in us. We do nothing to save ourselves. We can't get the candy out of the jar by ourselves. It has to be poured out into us. But this gave way over these 1,500 years between the time that Jesus lived and died and rose again. This crept in. Certainly I must do something to be saved. Certainly I must do something. I must act in a certain way. Saved by faith alone turned into works righteousness. In other words, I earn forgiveness, or I can even pay for forgiveness. And after 1,500 years, this got progressively worse and progressively entrenched into the Christian church, until one person got up and said, wait a minute, what about the gospel? What is the good news? I can't do this. Nobody can do this perfectly. Martin Luther in Wittenberg, Germany, found or rediscovered the gospel that was hiding in plain sight, which is the heart work for this week. Romans 3, 23 and 24. All have sinned and fall short of the glory of God and are justified freely by his grace as a gift through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus. And now it's time for us, 502 years later, to get back to these basics. We are sinners. We are saved by grace alone, through faith alone, revealed in Scripture alone, and all of this because of Christ alone. And so where does this lead us when we start to get back to these basics? It leads us right back here to the church. And back to the basics means to be getting back to Christ. But pastor, I can experience Christ anywhere. Remember, he's omnipresent, pastor. You taught me that in confirmation class. I can go out in the forest preserve. I can be spending time with my family. I don't need to go to church. In fact, I can experience Christ even better away from the church. Yes, Christ is omnipresent. He can be experienced everywhere because he is just about everywhere. There's at least one place he isn't. That's in hell. But where has Jesus promised, without a doubt, even if you don't feel it, even if you don't see it, he is without a doubt here in this place. It is in the church. You experience Christ first here at the baptismal font. You experience Christ whenever you read or hear the Word of God, which is taught and preached here in the church. Jesus continues to come to you in, with, and under the bread and the wine of Holy Communion. What's the big deal about going to church? You come into the presence of Jesus here, and you come together. You are with other people who believe the same types of things. It's a family. Isn't that what we're getting to be all about in the next couple weeks? Gathering together as a family to rejoice and to give thanks. That's what this is all about. This is getting back to the basics. Now, the reality of today is that there are Lutherans, there are Roman Catholics, there are Baptists, there are Presbyterians and others. The reality is that we do have our differences. We have our differences in both practice, how we practice our Christianity, and we do have some differences in our teachings of what we believe the Bible to tell us. But the reality of Reformation Day is that we are all, and I do mean all of us, are saved by Jesus Christ, empowered by Jesus Christ, and called by Jesus Christ to get back to the basics. Grace, faith, Scripture. Why? To tell others about Jesus Christ. Because when we get back to the basics, we will be able to tell others the truth. God loves them and has saved them through Jesus Christ alone. In His name, amen. Would you please stand with me and join me in confessing our Christian faith? We'll use the words of the Apostles' Creed. It's at the bottom of page 5 of the service folder and on the screen above. Together, out loud, I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Congregation, please be seated. And our service continues now as we bring our tithes, our offerings, and our We Care cards to the Lord.
Who are the children we have seen? Have you? You are the children.
Sunday of the month here at St. Matthew is Bread for Life, and we collect bread for the Cool Food Pantry, and we pray, we bless the loaves, that the people would then receive the bread of life, Jesus Christ. We bless the loaves. Father Almighty, Lord of heaven and earth, we thank you for the benevolent way you bless your creation, and we thank you for the bountiful way you have blessed us. We pray that you would bless these loaves, that they feed those less fortunate, but that they also hear of the bread of life, your Son, our Savior, Jesus, the Christ. Amen. Congregation is invited to stand for prayer. And together, let us pray. Almighty and gracious Lord, pour out your Holy Spirit on your faithful people. Keep us steadfast in your grace and truth. Protect and deliver us in times of temptation. Defend us against all enemies, and grant to your church your saving peace. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Gracious God, you have renewed your church in every age and generation with the voices of those who recall your people to the gospel and who speak your word in times both easy and difficult. Receive our thanks for the blessed Martin Luther and those with him who contended for the gospel against many and great enemies. Make us so bold that we may, in our own age and in our own time, get back to the basics and contend for the faith against those who would silence our voices or distract your people from the one true gospel of Christ crucified and risen. Lord, in your mercy, Holy Lord, you continue to bless your church with faithful pastors and church workers who are determined to know only Jesus Christ. Bless those who serve your people with the means of grace, that they may be preserved in temptation and sustained in trial. We also give thanks and pray for all who willingly give up their time in your ministry here at St. Matthew. We offer gift, Ladies Aid, LWML, Women's Guild, Coffee Hour, Cool Food Pantry, Meals on Wheels, Sharing the Joy, Evangelism, St. Matters, Music Ministries, those who assemble the service folder, restock the We Care cards, envelopes in the pews, and restock the children's bags and garden club themselves. Lord, in your mercy, we thank you, gracious God, for the blessings the congregation of St. Matthew has received through the efforts of the Comfort Dog Ministry, and particularly through our Comfort Dog Lady, who has now departed this life and is permanently deployed serving the saints. May we always cherish all that you, dear Lord, have done through her in our midst. Lord, in your mercy. Almighty God, your word is truth. Keep us from abandoning pure doctrine and preserve us from pride, lest we fail to use your truth to call a new generation to know you and love you. Be with all the baptized, particularly with Bryn Emily, the daughter of James and Catherine Rollins, who, just yesterday, your Spirit brought into the family of our Father. May we all live out fully the new life you have granted to us by water and word, and guide us to serve our neighbors in love, especially those in need. Lord, in your mercy, we give thanks to you, gracious Father in heaven, with those who have reason to celebrate your gracious care. For Linda Corbin, the daughter of John and Janet Schaffman, who celebrates the anniversary of her birth this weekend. Lord, in your mercy. Lord God, our Heavenly Father, we ask you to bless all the activities of St. Matthew this weekend. For all involved in the Everyone His Witness workshop, the Fall Festival, and those who will be attending the organ dedicatory recital and hymn sing this afternoon. Bless all with the desire to return to your house and hear the promises you have made in your holy word. Lord, in your mercy, merciful God, deliver the sick in accordance with your will, relieve their suffering, and grant them patience and peace, especially Kristen Skinner, Marvin Stella, Bob and Penny Martin, Brianna Huggerbaugh, Kristen Baskin, Kristen Peterson Wisher, and Regina Musa. We also pray for Becky Nall, the sister of Pat Trapp and Vicki Principal, for
For Gina DeRosa, the daughter of Les Laughlin. For Rich Bloom, a friend of Jim Brown's. For Peggy Ventinelli, the sister-in-law of Herb and Dolly Watts. Jody Barnes, daughter of Richard and Bobby Maple. Anthony Caprietti, the son of Dustin and Amanda Caprietti. Beth Hayes, the daughter of Tom and Carol Hayes. And Forrest Peck, a grandson of David and Deborah Shelley. We pray for all the homebound, particularly Roy Hoover, and we take a moment to pause and pray for those we hold in the quiet of our own hearts and minds. Give to the aged your comfort and peace. Give to the grieving hope and the consolation of the gospel and the resurrection of the dead. Lord, in your mercy, preserve your church, O Lord, and each of us as members of Christ's body, that we may not surrender the true gospel for any reason, but keep in this faith and fear throughout the days of our earthly pilgrimage, until the day when we and all your people shall stand before the judgment seat of Christ to receive the reward you have prepared for us and all who have loved his appearance. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, we pray, who with the Father and the Holy Spirit, you are one God, now and forevermore. Amen. We pray the prayer Jesus gave us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. I thank you, my heavenly Father, through Jesus Christ, your dear Son, that you have kept me this night from all harm and danger. And I pray that you would keep me this day also from sin and every evil, that all my doings and life may please you. For into your hands I commend myself, my body, soul, and all things. Let your holy angel be with me, that the evil of all may have no power over me. Amen.
And the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen. Congregation, you're invited to please be seated. For just a few announcements, we give thanks to the Lord that you are with us this day. If this is your first time with us, please sign the guest book out in the narthex. And there's also a mug there for you if you would like to take that home. Today at 3:00, there will be, as you heard in the prayers, a dedicatory organ recital and hymn sing based on the Reformation, and you all are welcome to come back and listen to this fine instrument with which the Lord has blessed us. The Christmas Bazaar and Craft and Gift Sale is next Saturday, November 2nd, from 9:00 to 2:00 in the level below the sanctuary. Donations are still being received for the Thanksgiving baskets. A $20 donation will provide a turkey and all the fixings for a family in need. Donation envelopes can be pulled off the display, located right out of the narthex, just behind Pastor Blonsky, as you greet him after the service. Then you can put the $20 check or bill in the envelope and place it in the cornucopia on the church office counter. With those things in mind, let's stand to sing Shout to the North.
I love and sing of the great and glorious King. You are strong when you feel weak. In your brokenness, come to me.
Shout to the north and the south. Sing to the east and the west. Of the truth.